In her quiet home in Oxford, Stephanie Daly is preparing for a journey that could rewrite history.
There's always a bit of nervousness about, but that keeps you on the qui vive, doesn't it? So it's an adventure.
She's come up with a controversial new theory that, if right, will solve one of the world's last great archaeological mysteries. The exact location of one of the seven wonders of the ancient world.
We have to reassess everything we thought we knew about the Hanging Garden of Babylon.
Since it was built nearly 3,000 years ago, no one has found a single trace.
Well, I'm glad I've got a good pair of shoes on.
Now Stephanie thinks she has tracked it down.
It all begins here.
But to prove her theory, she will have to go to one of the most dangerous places on the planet.
We'll have good advice on it. We'll have good security. I mean, riding a bicycle in Oxford's quite dangerous.
The seven wonders of the ancient world. Among them, the pyramids at Giza. The lighthouse that once stood at Alexandria. The mighty colossus of Rhodes. Most have been lost, but traces of all have been found. All have been placed. All except one. Everything we know about the Hanging Garden comes from a few accounts, written hundreds of years after they were built, by people who never saw them. They say it was a garden where trees appeared to be suspended in the air, and where water flowed against gravity. These accounts place it in Babylon, just south of what is now modern-day Baghdad.
All our sources say that the Hanging Gardens at Babylon were there, at Babylon. And so it's been assumed that's where they must have been.
These same accounts say it was built 600 years before Christ by King Nebuchadnezzar, a paradise in the desert, as a gift for his wife who missed the green mountains of her home. But in the writings of the time, there's not one mention of any garden.
We have lots of records from the time of Nebuchadnezzar, his own inscriptions deposited in the foundations of his buildings.
Nebuchadnezzar's texts have all been searched exhaustively.
He talks about building temples, refurbishing temples, restructuring the ancient cults, but also he focuses on his great palaces he constructs at Babylon. But in the hundreds of documents which record his building works, there's no mention of gardens at all.
Hundreds of texts, and not a single mention of a garden. And there's another problem. Despite dozens of expeditions digging in Babylon, no one has ever found a trace of archaeological evidence. Not a single piece.
Nowhere in his texts or on the ground any evidence for the gardens. No evidence for it in the archaeological record.
Many scholars even question whether the garden existed at all. But now a new idea has turned everything we thought we knew about the Hanging Garden on its head.
Well, it began to look as if we simply had the wrong place, the wrong king, the wrong story altogether. So why was this? And that was the big question. If we couldn't find the garden in Babylon when we excavated all around the palaces of Nebuchadnezzar, and if we couldn't find them in the inscriptions of Nebuchadnezzar, which were complete, either the whole story, the whole legend, was a complete fiction, or the gardens were somewhere else.
Stephanie Daly is a code breaker. One of a handful of people in the world who can read ancient cuneiform text. A script so obscure, we're only just beginning to reveal its secrets.
Cuneiform writing was a marvellous script, but it's very, very complicated. It started around 3000 BC and comes to an end around the time of Christ.
Metaphors are at the heart of this writing.
It's not alphabetic. It's got hundreds of signs, and every sign has several different possible readings. When you excavate these things, you have the opportunity of reading literature and other things that haven't been read before, since at least the time of Christ.
For more than 2,000 years, these ancient voices have been lost, with no one able to read a word. Things started to change when Stephanie began studying the cuneiform on a prism at the British Museum. A prism that described the life of another king called Sennacherib, a king who lived 100 years before Nebuchadnezzar.
We're looking at an eight-sided prism from the palace of Sennacherib. The beginning of this inscription tells you that he's king of Assyria, he's king of the world, he's conquered many lands, and he gives you a rundown of his main conquests.
Sennacherib lived 700 years before Christ. He reigned over an empire that stretched from southern Turkey to modern-day Israel. The prism comes from the very heart of Sennacherib's capital.
The whole thing would have been hidden in the wall of the palace, or the foundations of the palace, so that when the palace fell down eventually, people could still see what a great king Sennacherib was. It tells you about this wonderful palace that he built, and then it tells you about the garden that he built alongside the palace.
But the prism described something more than just another garden.
On this prism, Sennacherib says, "I raised the height of the surroundings of the palace to be a wonder for all peoples." I think his description refers both to the palace and to the garden. The two go together.
Translations from the prism even suggested what Sennacherib's garden might have looked like.
One part of this says that a high garden, imitating the Amanus Mountains, I laid out next to the palace, with all kinds of aromatic plants, orchard fruit trees, trees that sustain the mountains and Babylonia, as well as trees that bear wool planted within it. Well, that's almost certainly a form of the cotton plant.
The writings seem to suggest Sennacherib built an extravagant garden, which he then filled with exotic fruit trees and plants from lands across his empire. This information meant Stephanie began to look more closely at other contemporary evidence, evidence that had previously been dismissed. Sennacherib and other great Assyrian kings lined their palace walls with bas-reliefs, huge carvings that describe the world around them. This, known as the garden relief, was removed from Sennacherib's capital city and brought to the British Museum. It shows his palace complex and a garden. Trees hanging in the air on terraces, and plants suspended on arches. But because it wasn't from Babylon, it had been ignored.
The garden relief shows water coming along halfway up the garden on arches. and they look as if they're stone arches, the way that they're shown. And that is, I think, one of the things that makes it a really extraordinary garden, a hanging garden.
It was a revelation. The prism and relief both placed the garden in Sennacherib's capital. And Sennacherib's capital was nowhere near Babylon. It was at Nineveh, more than 400 kilometers to the north. But the problem is that Nineveh is now part of modern-day Mosul, one of the most dangerous places on Earth. No Western archaeologist has been there since the war. On average, 3 to 5 terrorist attacks occur every day. But Stephanie thinks she has a way to gather evidence to support her theory. She heads to Erbil, in Iraqi Kurdistan, just 80 kilometers from Nineveh. Compared to the rest of the country, it's a safe and stable base. And it's a part she knows well.
I first came here in 1967. We were digging in northern Iraq. There'd been a certain amount of trouble there, as there often is, but we got through easily. That's me there. And that one's the man who became my husband.
Your romance blossomed on this trip.
Eventually.
Tomorrow, from her base here in Erbil, Stephanie will begin to put her theory to the test. Stephanie Daly is in Iraq, gathering evidence to support her new theory on the Hanging Garden of Babylon. But it's going to be tough. In high summer, temperatures reach nearly 40 degrees Celsius in this part of the world. An early start is critical. For Stephanie, the first step is to prove that Sennacherib had the expertise to get water to a garden in the heart of this arid country. She was here nearly 50 years ago and saw the beginnings of a canal system in the mountains at Hinis. She decides to head back to the site.
Well, we're off to see where the water starts at the head of Sennacherib's great canal scheme. When I came before, I thought there were many more people around. You'd see a lot of children in the villages, you'd see a lot of fruit trees, a lot of chickens. And I think now, when you go through the villages, there's much less sort of family life going on.
When Stephanie finally reaches the site, the sheer scale of Sennacherib's building project is revealed.
And there's Sennacherib. Well, Sennacherib is recording in a very visual form the greatness of what he did. He is showing that he has inaugurated this wonderful system of water management, bringing the water all the way to Nineveh and to his hanging garden. And he's showing himself together with the great gods, and that the gods support him, because that's the important thing. If the gods stop supporting the king, he's on his way out.
These reliefs survived centuries, until hermits moved into the area and destroyed them. The enormous holes became caves used as shelters. And everywhere, Sennacherib has left his mark. Proud, powerful, celestial.
It's evident that this is his work because of this monument. And not just this one, but there are small niches with a picture of the king all the way along here. I find it very moving that it is still here. You can still come and see it. You could go up and touch it if you wanted. You could kiss Sennacherib's feet. I know it's ruined. Perhaps that adds to the romance of it, in fact. It's a very impressive monument, and thank God it's still here.
Water from this river was taken and routed into a vast canal network.
This is the huge rock where the water was divided in two. We've got the mountain river coming down through the gorge over there, and it's circling around here, and at this point it's diverted half of it into the canal. And you can't see the line of the canal now because they've made a car park there, but it would have continued past our vehicle towards the flagpole and on towards Nineveh. Well, we're standing at a sort of key point for the whole project. It all begins here.
2,700 years ago, this giant rock would have split the river and diverted half the water into Sennacherib's canal system. The canal was perfectly engineered to allow water to flow steadily, dropping a single meter for every kilometer of its journey, keeping a gentle, manageable pace until it reached Nineveh. This canal system, built hundreds of years before the Roman Empire even existed, was a staggering achievement.
There would have been a most enormous ceremony here when the whole system was opened up for the first time. They would have had tremendous ceremony, and the king would have been here, and probably a great feast took place.
You sound like you wish you had been there.
Oh, yes, I'm hoping to meet Sennacherib one day. Well, it's nice to imagine it here because you have the scenery for it and you have the occasion.
While the site at Hinnis demonstrates Sennacherib's ambition, it doesn't show the scale of his canal network or how this relates to Nineveh. In order to see whether this canal system could be connected with Nineveh, Stephanie arrives back in Erbil. It's a task made more difficult because much of the evidence for his ancient canals has been lost to modern life. She's come here to find out about a new project that promises to reveal the secrets of Sennacherib's great work.
A bit later today, we're off to see my colleague Jason Orr from Harvard, who studies in a quite different way from myself the landscape that Sennacherib inhabited, changed forever, really.
Jason Orr uses declassified spy material to study ancient landscapes. In particular, the area ruled by Sennacherib.
We have to sort of peel back the landscape that is currently available, that we can see nowadays, and look at how it must have been in the time of Sennacherib.
Well, I've used a Corona program, this American spy satellite program that started in the 1960s. It's been declassified since the mid-90s, and now it's available for literally anybody to use, including the people that the Americans were spying on. It reveals fantastic details of the ancient world.
Corona satellites took snapshots of landscapes, as they were before modern cities built up, before modern roads. And in this part of Iraq, the landscapes have not changed for thousands of years.
The inscriptions can tell us a lot. They can tell us the thoughts of the people that wrote them, but we never must forget that those people had an agenda. So here's where the satellite imagery comes in. It shows us the landscape in a very objective way. It doesn't lie.
Jason,
Stephanie, how are you?
Very good to see you again.
Jason's work reveals just how big Sennacherib's canal system is. stretching from the Zagros Mountains that border Iran. It runs across the plains of northern Iraq, all the way through to Nineveh.
So we're looking here at a canal that leads from the Zagros up to the north, and it directs the entire flow of this river across this watershed into this other river system. Now, this is not necessarily easy to see from the ground, but this image gives you a fantastic idea of just how screamingly obvious it is from a vertical perspective.
So, on the ground, how wide would that canal be?
From top to top, it's 100 meters wide, and it's probably about 20 meters deep.
In parts, Sennacherib's waterways are the width of the Panama Canal, and they run downhill at a precise angle across 95 kilometers of parched terrain.
What have you got here to get the canal from there to there?
This is one of the engineering jewels of the Assyrian Empire. This canal that you can faintly trace here, it has to go around this entire valley. But to get there, it has to cross this stream. And that's where this feature comes in. It's a little ambiguous on the imagery, but this is an aqueduct. This is a 2 million block stone aqueduct. This feature carries the water from this side of the plain across this watercourse and then carrying on around the head of the valley and ultimately to the capital at Nineveh. And it really is a masterpiece of Assyrian engineering.
Well, it's astonishing, isn't it, to imagine Sennacherib and his engineers seeing that whole picture without the sort of maps that we have. So what we can see on those photographs is that Sennacherib and his engineers were phenomenal, that it was something quite out of the ordinary, quite magnificent in scope, design and execution.
It was clear that Sennacherib had the technology to build a huge canal network. But did he have the engineering skills to build a huge terrace garden? Stephanie decides to go and see the aqueduct Jason had pointed out on his satellite map to see what it will reveal. The Jerwan Aqueduct. This is one of the earliest known aqueducts in history. It predates anything the Romans built by 500 years.
Well, I'm glad I've got a good pair of shoes on.
It's so solid. I mean, look at the size of those pieces of stone. You could almost imagine a giant having to compose this.
Sennacherib was so proud of his achievements. He was keen to tell the world that this was his work.
We know who built this because he wrote his name, his title, his father's name, on these stones here. It's written in cuneiform. It goes from left to right, just like English. He says, Mr. Sennacherib, the king of the world, king of the land of Assyria. There's no doubt at all who built this. Not modest at all. He wanted to make sure that his legacy lasted forever. And it's done quite well, 2,700 years or so.
For Stephanie, there are bigger clues here. Clues that shed light on the idea of the Hanging Garden being further downstream.
What we've got here is the remains of an arch in this aqueduct. And I think you can see that the stones are gradually shaped in towards the centre at the top, which is no longer preserved.
Five arches, built from 2 million perfectly carved stone blocks. This extraordinary structure would support Sennacherib's canal at a height of 9 meters above the ground. And it would have been 22 meters wide. But for Stephanie, there's something even more significant about the aqueduct. Something that reminded her of the garden relief at the British Museum.
If we look on a drawing of it where the thing is a bit clearer, we can see the shape of the top of those arches on the drawing. And it's quite interesting that on this, we can see that they've drawn in the stones.
The arches shown on the garden relief match the designs of the arches supporting the aqueduct at Jerwan.
We can see that this is real, and it helps us to understand that what we see here is not a bit of make-believe. They're showing what the king did in detail, and they're not fairy tale imaginary pictures at all. They're trying very hard in two dimensions to represent something enormous that the king did in three dimensions.
For Stephanie, the aqueduct proves that the garden relief is more than a piece of art that once decorated a palace wall at Nineveh. It's a piece of documentary evidence.
We've seen the rock sculptures and the canal leading out from the mountains at Chinnis. And now we've found the place where an aqueduct solves the problem of crossing the major tributary. And then we think of this whole network making its way very carefully all the way to Nineveh. The thing is, it's not just a garden, is it? It's a world wonder on several different counts. This whole waterworks is a part of what makes the Hanging Garden a world wonder. And it shows the character of Sennacherib. He's not afraid of a big project, and he has the expertise to carry it out. And it works when he's done it.
Stephanie has arrived back in Erbil. She's learned that Sennacherib built a huge canal system, stretching nearly 100 kilometers to his capital at Nineveh. And using old archaeological surveys, she's also pinpointed the location she thinks is the Hanging Garden.
What we've got here is a map that was made in 1904. We know that's a part of the palace of Sennacherib. Now, some people think that's just about all there was, but other people think that it was much bigger than that and that it extended all the way along here. If we think it does come along this far, that would be a good place there for the garden.
Sennacherib's palace complex stretched 400 meters in length. To the rear was a huge open space Stephanie believes is the site for his garden.
Sennacherib's own inscription says that he raised the level of the earth beside the palace to make a garden.
But there are critical details Sennacherib fails to give. He doesn't tell us how the garden was laid out, or how large it was. Other writers, living hundreds of years after the garden was built, claim they knew.
We only know about the size of the gardens from what the Greek writers say. But one of the Greek authors, Diodorus Siculus, tells us just what the dimensions were. He says the park extended 4 plethora on each side. And then he says that it sloped downwards on these terraces and resembled a Greek theatre.
A plethora is an ancient measurement. 4 plethora equates to about 123 metres.
The way that I think you can interpret this is we've got essentially a rectangle and we've got 123 metres along the top and 123 metres along the side. And that's the dimensions that Diodorus gives.
The size and shape of the garden given fits the available space alongside the palace.
And then he says that it resembles a theatre because of these terraces rising up. So we envisage it coming like this, and then the lake down at the bottom there. So that's roughly what it would have looked like, is a large Greek or Roman amphitheatre with a lake at the bottom.
An immense, thirsty amphitheatre of plants, nourished by a vast canal system. But an issue for Sennacherib still remained. How did this water get to the uppermost reaches of his garden? How were these great trees kept alive?
Scholars have estimated that this particular hanging garden would have needed about 300 tons of water a day, and that's an enormous amount of water.
Without modern technology, lifting 300 tons of water per day by hand would have been a huge problem.
So how are we going to get the water up there? It's a phenomenal question as to how it was done.
Stephanie had been working through Sennacherib's writing when she came across a word that didn't seem to make any sense.
He says, in order to draw water up all day long, I had ropes, bronze wires and bronze chains made, and I set up the great cylinders and alamitu over cisterns. He's drawing up water all day long. This is not a bucket and chain job from a well. But what on earth did he mean by the alamitu?
Sennacherib, it seemed, had come across a solution. But the details were hidden behind the word alamitu. She finally traced the meaning of the word. It's a plant, in particular a type of date palm. But what did a date palm have to do with lifting water?
We saw that you had a palm tree.
For Stephanie, seeing a date palm is critical. Because it's only when you see a date palm that you can understand what Sennacherib was driving at.
This tree is significant because you can see where the fronds have been cut off as the trunk has gone up. You can see the scars from the fronds making a spiral pattern around the whole of the trunk.
A spiral pattern around the trunk of the tree. The palm's surface is shaped like a screw, the kind of screw used for drawing water uphill. Silent, and able to keep a constant amount of water flowing against gravity, it would have been an engineering breakthrough. Sennacherib was using the shape of a date palm to describe an Archimedes screw.
When you invent something, you've got to find words for it. Like on your computer, you have this mouse. Well, you know, that could be quite perplexing in the future for people who talk about mice on desks. Here, we've got something that maybe they've already invented and they know what it looks like, but how are they going to find a word for it? They look in nature for something that has it too. And this is what provides them with a word that they can use for it, that everybody will understand.
The Archimedes screw is named after the Greek who invented it. But Sennacherib was seemingly using it 400 years before Archimedes had even been born.
I looked at what various writers had said about Archimedes and the water-raising screw, and they thought the screw itself was older than Archimedes. So I felt some relief at that. Because you don't want to go out too much on a limb. Sennacherib solved this enormous problem of raising water from that aqueduct halfway up the garden and getting it right up to the top above the pillared walkway. And he does it with these screws. And that is a stroke of genius, really.
The focus of Stephanie's investigation is now about getting access to the site at Nineveh. Nineveh and the neighboring city of Mosul are effectively closed to Westerners, and things are getting worse. During the month of Stephanie's visit, a car bomb exploded at a book market. 47 people were killed or injured. On average, 100 people are killed every month. Four days into the trip, we've got a solution to get into the site.
We've come up with a plan to send local security people with cameras, and they are getting the bit of the mound at Nineveh that we're interested in.
Hello.
Do come in, please.
Neo and Mustafa have arrived to receive their instructions from Stephanie.
Can we get straight to our map?
The advantage is that local security can work in Nineveh without attracting any attention.
So, you'll be starting here with the roofed area.
The footage they bring back will be the first Stephanie has been able to study of the site.
We want to look at this bit here.
They have a maximum of 1 hour filming at the location. After that, using cameras around the site will make them too conspicuous, and it will become too dangerous.
You'll be coming out here. You may have to come through a fence.
They have to get to the possible garden location quickly.
From the palace to this area, what do you think? I mean, about the distance from here to there?
Right, about 400 meters. Roughly. And this is the area that we really want you to focus on here.
Okay.
As much as you can of that. We'll see how the land lies in the bit of Sennacherib's palace that is still recognizable. And then, above all, the bit that I'm most interested in, those contours which correspond to what we know about the Hanging Garden.
Neo and Mustafa set off on their two-hour drive to Nineveh. They have to pass through four checkpoints, which are often targeted by terrorists. They've been given a camera each, and will be calling Stephanie when they get to the site.
How are you feeling?
Well, nervous. Nervous. I do hate waiting. I'm quite an impatient person, I suppose, and I also from the West, I've got in the habit of being punctual for things, so when there's any delay, I chomp at the bit rather.
Mustafa and Neo's trip has been harder than expected. There have been four attacks on the outskirts of Nineveh. One person has been killed. Then, after nearly 4 hours, some good news. The information is fed to Stephanie through her security advisor.
Okay, they're inside.
Good.
So, they're just waiting to start the process of filming.
Okay. Thanks. Okay. Good.
But the clock is ticking. Neo and Mustafa filmed for 1 hour, and then they're told to leave the site. Eventually, Neo and Mustafa return with the footage they shot in Nineveh. Images Stephanie never thought she'd see.
Very, very nice to see you.
I thank you so much for what you've done.
We thank God that we are safe.
Yes. Well, we thank God too.
The area is an archaeological site in the center of Nineveh, under the control of the Department of Antiquities. After being given access to the site, they enter the excavated part of the palace. Their contact guides them around the ruins. Despite the damage, there's no disguising the scale.
So here we are in Sennacherib's palace.
Yes. And so what's this rock?
I think that's a bit of a winged bull. That's the hind leg, the bottom, the back of the bull.
Yeah,
it's quite interesting to see the stone and how... Oh, yes. Oh, there's some wonderful shell in the stone there. Oh, look at it. Oh, yes, these are the trees, like the ones in Sennacherib's garden, according to the sculpture that we have.
It shows Sennacherib's fascination with plant life and the natural world, just like the carvings on the garden relief.
It's a mountain landscape. When they have these sort of diamond kinds of background, that shows you're in the mountains. So I think these might be fruit trees, but I'm not sure.
The images show an ancient city in a terrible state of disrepair. The Global Heritage Fund named Nineveh as one of 12 sites most on the verge of irreparable destruction and loss.
It is in a sad state, but it's still very exciting. Those slabs that you see there, we've lost the sculpture on the outside of them. But still, it gives you a feel for the scale of it all, doesn't it?
Yes.
You feel how impressive it was.
Yes, exactly.
Of course, it would have been perfect.
When I went over there, I felt that I'm living in another world.
Yes, yes.
With their hour running down, it's time to move on. At the height of its powers, Nineveh was the world's largest city. It takes time to get around. Mustafa and Neo now head towards the rear of Sennacherib's palace, getting closer to the area Stephanie thinks is the location of the garden. It becomes quickly apparent that much of the old city is now used as farmland.
They're ploughing right up to the edge. That's... Yes, well... How much is lost every year? You imagine thousands of years when this site has been eroded, damaged, looted. People come up for picnics. They find, look what I found. And they take it home. And you can't blame them. Oh, but look how difficult it is to see any sort of... to interpret any of the land. It is so eroded. Can you just show us where we are on the map at this moment?
Well, exactly there.
Exactly there.
Yeah.
Great. So you're walking towards the area that has the red circle around it.
As Mustafa and Neo arrive at the spot circled on the map, Stephanie is initially downhearted.
We know for certain he had a palace garden. It must be somewhere here. This seemed to me a very likely spot. But now we're here, of course, we don't see a garden, that's for sure, and we don't see any trace of what we hoped might be visible.
Then she spots something that gives her hope. The extraordinary view from the citadel, overlooking the plains of northern Iraq.
It's a perfect place for a garden, looking over the river. Sennacherib tells us so in his inscription, and he says it was a marvel for all peoples.
a wonder of the world, in his own words.
The chain of evidence ends here. An enormous engineering feat, starting in the mountains nearly 100 kilometers away, that brought water steadily along huge canals, finally arriving at a garden resembling an amphitheater. Stone arches, like those on the aqueduct, carrying 300 tons of water to plants from across the Assyrian Empire. With screws working silently to lift the water to the upper terraces. And aromatic trees that freshen the palace air for anyone walking amongst them. Gardens built by a king to demonstrate his mastery over nature. Stephanie's frustration is that as long as conflict continues, any detailed archaeological study of the site remains impossible. It's just too dangerous. For the moment, Stephanie has got as far as anyone can get.
We have seen Sennacherib at work in his canals, in his sculptures, in his palace. We've seen the site of the garden. And we have seen Sennacherib had the brilliance and the expertise to make a wonder of the world. It's been wonderful.
It's one of the best known battles and dates in our history. The Time Team is looking for 1066, the lost battlefield, next Sunday at 8. Next tonight, Carrie is on the trail of a key suspect in the Langley bombing. It's new. Homeland.